So it's 6 o'clock. That means call the meeting to order. Andy, please roll call.
Sure. Directors Weed.
Here.
Gunther.
Here.
Koller.
Here.
Sethy.
Here.
And Huang.
Here. Director Gunther, would you do us the honor?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Sorry, glasses. Do you want to introduce the action first or public comments?
Public comments.
All right, next is public comments. Members of the public may address the board on any issues not listed on the agenda, which are within the purview of the Alameda County Water District. Members of the public who wish to address the board on a scheduled agenda item should approach the speaker's podium at the time the item is introduced. I'll open the public comment, and each speaker has 5 minutes. Mr. Ramos? Five? Would you like more?
My name is Gregory Lemos.
I live at 5788 by Congress in
and I wanted to thank Gina for sending me an email on the wells and I don't know if I can pronounce it right, the MLS station of land substance. I asked last time about the wells, drying up and stuff. So I'm not here, so if somebody would let her know that I got the mail and thank you. Have you ever had something that sticks in your mind you can't get rid of?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I have a little thing, and it's called security. I got burglarized twice in Fremont. So it's something that kind of sticks in my mind. And without going a lot of detail, the gate at Bellflower site is not secured. It's locked, but not secured. I looked up secured on the dictionary, and it says, well fastened. Well, I called San Francisco Water Company because they have the gate. They own the right away. And they say, well, ACWD is the one that uses the gate mostly. So that gets it back to ACWD. So tonight I'd just like to say that San Francisco and ACWD is unnoticed. That if something happens, I mentioned it. On Thursday, the 4th, I had a water leak at the meter, and the ACWD came out and fixed it. So thank you for the quick response on that. the water meter readers, when they open up that little thing, the meter, maybe they can see down there, see if it's wet. Because my experience with washers is that it starts to drip a little at a time. I used to have a faucet in the house. It starts to drip a little at a time. This thing went, whew. And I was out there cutting the lawn, and I stepped into a puddle. I opened my drain, it was gushing water. So without thinking, I got a bucket and I started. And after I filled the bucket twice, I said, dummy, just turn the damn thing off. So I went down, I got a crescent wrench and whatever, and I turned it off. By that time, the fellow came.
And he said, oh, thank you.
And
within 5 minutes, he had that thing fixed.
He had the right tools.
And my thoughts were, I lost water, and I have to pay for it. But I didn't put that meter in. You know, I'm obligated from the meter to the house.
So what about that meter? Who's responsible,
I
put it in.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a thought
that I'd like to bring out tonight.
So we do have a policy on, water use as a result of leaks. So once you receive your bill, if you have any questions, you can call our customer service and we can arrange for that to be addressed.
In fact, I think one of the meetings that had a lady come up, she had a tremendous amount of water. But the thing is, I didn't lose a lot of water because I checked the meter reading with my last bill, and if I lost anything, maybe one unit. Is it $2.37 or is it $3.45, whatever it is?
I think I can afford that. But if it had been gallons,
and I imagine the people that work, they leave their home in the morning, they come back in the evening, they never pay attention to that thing. And, anyway, that's what I like to say tonight. I didn't use up my 5 minutes, but
thank you very much. And can I have staff follow up on the secure gate at Bill Flower Well site, please?
Sure.
Thank you. With that, do I have any other members of the public that wish to speak? If not, let's move on to item 4, consent calendar. Before we move on that, I believe General Manager has some corrections.
Yes, thank you, Madam President. I just want to point out that in the latest version of the board packet, there's a correction to the July minutes. And for the record, the dates for the committee meetings were originally noted for those July meetings incorrectly, and they have now been corrected to the appropriate June dates. So that's all.
All right. Thank you. Then let's move on to consent calendar. Do I have any directors that wish to add or remove any item, add any item to or remove any item from the consent calendar?
I'll move we add item 5.1.
Do I have a second?
I'll second the motion.
Andy?
Directors Weed?
Aye.
Gunther?
Aye.
Koller?
Aye.
Sethy?
Aye.
And Huang?
Aye. Do I have a motion to accept the consent calendar as amended?
I'll move consent calendar as amended.
I'll second.
Okay. Directors Weed?
Aye.
Gunther?
Aye.
Koller?
Aye.
Sethy?
Aye.
And Huang?
Aye. With that, let's move on to item 5.2, public hearing to receive comments on the draft Alameda County Water District report on water quality related to public health goal 2013-2015.
Yes, thank you, Madam President. Mr. Peterson, our manager of operations and maintenance, will kick off this item.
Thank you, Mr. Shaver. The Public Health Goal Report, or PHG report, is intended to provide the public with water quality information beyond what is included in the annual Consumer Confidence Report. State statute requires the board to hold a public meeting and to accept and respond to public comments to the PHG report. If public comments are made during the public hearing, staff will respond to them in the final PHG report. Notice of the public hearing was placed in the Argus, the Tri-City Voice, and on the district's website. No public comments have been received to date. The PHG report was reviewed with the Operations and Water Quality Committee meeting with the Water Quality Committee on May 11th, 2016. And environmental engineer Cynthia Ha will be making a presentation tonight summarizing the contents of the report. Cynthia?
Yes. Good evening, everyone. Today I'm going to present the draft reports on water quality relative to public health goals between 2013 and 2015. So why we prepare this report is because the California Health and Safety Code, Section 116470B, requires that utilities have more than 10,000 service connections in California and detect any water quality measurements above the public health goals and all the maximum containment level goals any time in the past 3 years must prepare a special report and hold a public hearing. The first report we prepared was in 2001, and we prepare the report every 3 years since then. And the last report we prepared is in 2013. Before going into the report, I want to explain some definitions that are used in the report. Maximum containment level is a regulatory standard which sets the highest level of constituents that's allowed in drinking water. Some constituents comply with the MCL by the 1-day annual average, which is the average of 12 consecutive monthly results. Action level is used by lead and copper rule, which has the 90 percentile value, which says that the concentration exceeded by 10% of the samples. Action level is not an MCL, but it triggers the treatment or other requirements that a water system must follow. Public health goals is not a regulatory standard, but is a non-enforceable goal. It's established by California Environmental Protection Agency's Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment. It's not enforceable. It's established based solely on public health risk and regardless of treatment feasibility or cost. Maximum containment level goal is also a non-enforceable goal. It's established by US EPA and is federal equivalent of PGs. The content of the reports includes it identified the constituents exceeding the PGs or MCLGs in 2013, 2014, and 2015. It identified the health risks associated with the constituents, and it described the best available technology and cost estimate for it to remove or reduce the constituents. So ACWD has routinely collecting samples to comply with the state and federal drinking water regulations. Of 105 PGs or MCLGs that's established, only two were exceeded in 2013 to 2015. Here is the summary table. Lead, which is collected during the lead and copper rule monitoring program in 2015 at the customer taps. The action level for lead is 15 micrograms per liter. The PG for lead is 0.2 micrograms per liter. And then we have the 90 percentile detection level at 8.1 micrograms per liter. And then the second constituent is bromate. The compliance for bromate is the range of the 1-day annual average complied quarterly. It's detected at the water treatment plant number 2 finished water. The detection for the bromate is 1.3 to 2.1 micrograms per liter. And I want to point out that bromate was non-detected in 2013. And because of the drought in 2014 and 2015, we have very challenging water to treat. And then we have low detection of bromate. And the PG for bromate is 0.1 micrograms per liter. And then the MCL for bromate is 10 micrograms per liter. And I'm going to talk more about these two constituents in the later slides. This diagram shows the 2015 lead monitoring. The red line is the action level for lead, which is 15 micrograms per liter. And then the PG is the green line, shows it's 0.2 micrograms per liter. And then we have a 90 percentile detection of 8.1 micrograms per liter, which is above the PG but below the MCL. So lead was not detected in our source water and our finished water. And lead is introduced to drinking water primarily through the internal corrosion of household plumbing. The health risk for lead is well known is neurological effects on children and hypertensive effects on adults. EPA consider treatment technique is the best available technology for lead control, and optimized corrosion control is one of the treatment technique. ACWD has the optimum corrosion control program in place since 1999. pH is adjusted at the finished water, and calcium carbonate precipitation potential control continuously at all production facilities as well. Since ACWD is achieving optimum corrosion control and continues to meet the action level for lead, no additional corrosion control treatment is recommended at this point, and no cost estimate associated with it as well. Besides the optimum corrosion control program, ACWD has several activities to assist the customer to reduce lead at the tap water. Water meters replacement program. ACWD implemented a school compound meter replacement program in 1999. We put an epoxy coating on the large compound meter at all public schools to prevent the lead leaching into the water. And only lead free meters have been installed in all new residential construction since 1999. Lead free, the definition for lead free is less than 0.25% of lead content at all wetted surface in all piping fittings and plumbing fixtures. All water meters have been continuously replaced with lead free meters. ACWD also have a public education program to teach customers how to reduce lead at their tap. Through ACWD website, we have frequently asked questions in our water quality session, and also we have information in the ACWD news and also in the annual water quality reports. We teach the customer to flush the tap about 30 seconds to 2 minutes before consumption and use cold water for drinking, cooking, or preparing baby formulas. This diagram shows that the bromate quarterly compliance. The red line is the MCL for bromate, which is 10 micrograms per liter. And then the green line is the pH for bromate is 0.1 micrograms per liter. The blue triangle here in 2013 shows bromate was non-detected in 2013. And because the draw, we have elevated bromide in our source water, and we have about 1.3 to 2.1 micrograms per liter bromate in our source water in 2014 and 2015. So ozonation is a very powerful tool to help us meet disinfection requirements and to control taste and odor. Bromate is a byproduct of the ozonation process. Bromide react with ozone and form bromate. Bromate is unique to the water treatment plant number 2 process because that's our only treatment plant with ozonation. The health risk for bromate is palpable carcinogen. ACBD is in full compliance with MCL 1 annual average. Bromate was not detected in 2013 and only low levels was detected in 2014 and 2015. Because of the drought, we have more than 35% of bromide in the source water in 2014 and 53% more bromide in 2015, comparing with the 2013 data. So this diagram shows the elevated bromide levels in the source water. The green bar shows the range of bromides in the source water from 2013 to 2015, and the blue line shows the average bromide in the source water. You can see that in 2014 and 2015, the bromide level increased significantly comparing with the 2013 bromide levels. So ACWD has several activities to reduce bromate since 2002. Peak suppression using carbon dioxide ahead of ozonation shows that which very effective in reducing the bromate below the MCL. And between 2007 and 2009, pre-chromination study for bromate control demonstrate that pre-chromination addition ahead of the ozone contactor is very effective and estimate bromate reduction by 81% comparing with the pH suppression. And in light of the result, through TP2 pre-chromination began in 2011. Bromate warning annual average was non-detected from 2011 to 2013. So the diffusion of drinking water and EPA consider control of ozone treatment process to reduce production of bromate as the best available technology for bromate control. ACWD currently has two primary bromate control strategy, pH suppression and pre-chromination. And because bromate was non-detected in 2011 to 2013, and even the source water is very challenging to treat between 2014 and 2015, we only have very low level of bromate was detected. In light of these results, and ACBD will continue to employ pre-chromination as our key bromate control strategy. And since we are already adopting the best available technology, we don't recommend additional treatment and no cost estimate associated with it. To sum up in the report, the recommendation is to maintain optimal corrosion control to reduce lead and to install only lead free meters in all new residential construction, and continue public education program through ACWD website and ACWD publications, and continue practicing precontamination as our primary bromate control strategies. Here's my presentation, and then I'm happy to take any questions.
Any questions from the directors?
I have a couple of questions.
Director Sethy?
Do we have any from the audience? Or you?
Actually, I'm going to have you ask staff questions, and then I'll open the public comment period.
So with the all the news that we've had about Flint, Michigan, and other communities where they've detected high levels of lead in the water, have we seen an increase in calls into our customer service or quality department about concerns about lead in our community?
Andy, how many calls has customer service received regarding lead in our water supply?
I believe we haven't received too many, Director Sethy, but we have received a few. We did receive one in writing that Laura responded to, Ms. Heidis responded to. And but general questions coming into our group, I would say maybe three or four since the Flint, Michigan reports.
Well, that's good to hear, because that tells me that our community outreach and how we're discussing things on our website through other communications is actually working.
I agree.
So I'm glad to hear that. And then with regard to bromate, from my understanding that if there's too much bromate in the water, that affects the taste and of the water, is that correct, or the odor? Does it have some effect on the water that a user can detect if there's too much bromide or bromate?
If I may, what primarily affects the taste and odors in the water are related to organic compounds, could be algae, could be other organics in the water. So ozonation does a very effective job of oxidizing those compounds and addressing taste and odor issues. Unfortunately, our source water has, at certain times of the year, depending upon what's happening in the delta, has significant amounts of salt and bromide in the water. So there's a chemical reaction between ozone and bromide that forms bromate. That's what we have to control. Bromate is not by itself a taste and odor compound.
If the bromate levels are too high, what is the public health concern?
Cynthia, you addressed that in your presentation.
Yes, so the MCL for bromate is 10, so exceed the MCL that is a concern for carcinogen is, carcinogenic.
If it's too high, what would be the health impact?
It's a potential carcinogenic, so cancer.
Yeah.
That's the primary concern. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. That's all I had to ask. Thank you very much for the presentation.
Yes, I have
Koller?
three questions. You talked specifically about pH control to maintain a effect on the lead outcome. And is it my understanding that chloramine does leach any lead fittings? That it does have an impact on any fittings that have lead in it?
Based on the research that's been made available to us, the answer is no. Now, there has been, years ago, concerns about rubber, types of rubber fittings and gaskets that were not resistant to chloramines. But as far as the leaching of lead from soldered joints that used lead solder prior to 1986, we're not aware in reading the literature that chloraminated water adversely affected that rate absorption into the water.
Okay. And that reminds me that in the hardware stores, both throughout the Tri-City area, there still is a lot of fittings, different fixtures that go into water closets that are rubber has rubber gaskets that have a direct impact with the chloramine. Now, I don't know how to take care of this, but I think we need a better education to educate the hardware stores and the outlets on utilizing the proper gaskets that they sell. So there may be something, I don't know how to handle that, but maybe our...
Certainly. This came up a number of years ago, and we addressed this with a significant effort on our frequently asked questions on our website. But since then, because I think there were some articles in the newspaper and national news, and that's what prompted the interest. Mm-hmm. But since then, we've had very few public comments or concerns, questions on this subject.
Yes, well, I personally am aware of the fact that there's a lot of rubber products that are out there that are being sold for plumbing fixtures. And I think we need to take this a little further in one of our committees and pursue some type of outreach.
Okay.
The second question is, has all the meters been replaced in the schools in the Tri-City area that have lead in them? Or do we have a percentage that are still with old meters?
So in that program, we take all the large compound meters that's more than 3 inches at all the public school, and then we put an epoxy coating in the internal side, and then to prevent the lead is leaching to the water.
Okay, yeah. So all of them been
all
addressed?
Of them. Yeah, all the public school.
Okay. Yeah. now, getting back to Director Sethy's comments on bromate, currently, what is our bromate level? I know you said 2015, mm-hmm. but it's now 2016. It's we're 2/3 of the way through the year. Mm-hmm. Where are we with our bromate level?
I don't have the data.
Our latest running average is probably on the between 1 and 2.
Okay.
It's at least that's what the average is.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Director Gunther.
Just have a comment. This report. I have difficulty because of how the law is set up in that, you know, we're required to take the maximum most effective or possible effective home in the system and report it as a possible defect. And it doesn't address what's really out there. It addresses the, you know, I don't know what the total percentages of, it would be interesting to see, of what the total percentages of dwellings, units, single family homes that would actually be in that range. Because we tend to, well, we're required to choose the worst. And the public perception can be swayed very easily, and this could be used in a very negative manner. And I give the district credit. I mean, we do our best, but that's why I've always had problems with this report. And it goes out and people see, oh my God, there's lead in the water. No, there's lead in the highest percentile homes where you might find it. The other difficulty I have is on our own website, we say to flush your tap to prevent this, which also kind of leads the public to say, oh, well, they're saying to do that, so there must be lead in our water. I know it's not the staff's fault. It's the way it's written. Congress loves to write laws. They're well-meaning. This is a well-meaning law. Certainly Flint, Michigan was a classic example. And across the country, the incredible thing I can't understand is how across the country there appear to be just non-compliance to this law. So I just hope the general public realizes what our staff does to meet this requirement and what this report really does say and what it says about our water. Our water is good. We're doing a phenomenal job, and I can't say anything better about what the staff does here. I just get concerned that it could be used against us in manners if somebody wanted to. So staff, keep it up. It's what we got to do. And it frustrates me to see media reports stating public water supplies are screwed up, and we're not. So that's all I've got to say.
Thank you, Director Gunther. Director Weed?
Yes, follow up. First of all, following up on Director Kohler's comments about rubber products. And I'm concerned that we'd be more accurate in our discussions on the type of product. Very little is rubber these days. It's some type of a plastic polymer. And it would be helpful to have whatever guidance is available if the industry's responded to the issues related to deterioration, presence of chloramines. That would be useful information. Next. Lead. The challenge we have with lead is that it's on the customer side of the meter. And it's specifically related to older installations for the most part. And there was a time when the building codes encouraged people to use lead plumbing. To that extent, have we identified the building, the point at which the building code changed? And the limited number of buildings that might be built and constructed under the earlier code. And the follow-on to that is, should we not be working with local city governments that when people come in for a new permit for a new hot water heater, et cetera, that we ask them to extend that permit to include the elimination of lead pipe if they encounter it, or lead solder in the older connections?
The rules changed in 1986. That's when lead solder was banned.
1986.
Okay. So buildings constructed prior to that would have used, perhaps, leaded solder. Subsequent to that, it was banned. And so what you're asking staff to do, if I understand you correctly, is to reach out to the development sections in city in the three cities and inquire about their building codes on when homes are refurbished, that a requirement be made that all their plumbing be ripped out and new plumbing put in that's lead free.
I'm reluctant to use the word require, but at least in public notification would be helpful.
Okay.
And there may be places where we could identify the immediate connections on the hot water service side where we would encourage people to either replace or take a look at the, where they're hooking the pipes up to.
Okay.
Director Weed, question. Prior to 1986, the use of leaded solder was fairly common, but most of the plumbing in our service area installed before that time is either copper or galvanized pipe.
Yes.
And, but I heard you mention lead pipe, which may be in the very, very oldest parts of our service area. Just a point of clarification, is that your primary concern, because that would seem to be the most egregious issue and certainly the biggest risk.
Yeah, and I would hope that that there be a provision that if there is leaded pipe, that lead pipe itself be removed if they recognize it. That I would agree as a could be should be considered a requirement because of the health issues. The solder is something that people live with for many years, and it's the risk is probably far less, but it's part to inform the public when if they have a building that's built prior to 1986. That type of a notification when they take out their permit might be something that might be informative to the homeowner. But I do agree that the where and if we do find lead pipe, and that may be a function of an age. I've uncovered at least one piece of lead pipe that was no longer in service in the town of Niles. So it does exist, or did exist.
Thank you. Also,
as did wood mains, which we have on Niles Boulevard.
Director Sethy?
Yes, just a short comment that we might want to alert people on our website that there are home lead testing kits that you can purchase. They're available on the internet through other hardware supply stores, things like that, that if you have an older home of a certain age, you might be encouraged to obtain one of those low-cost kits.
I think what we will do is there's a number of issues being brought up this evening, if it's okay with the board, and that's a great point. Maybe what we should do as staff is to sort of take a look at all of these issues and bring it to committee. Yes, does that
please.
Make sense?
Yeah.
And then
okay.
Follow up that way. There's a whole bunch of questions that I would have regarding customers, you know, testing water with a private, kit. We would want to assure ourselves that they're accurate, and so forth. So I think that would be my suggestion. Okay, let us look into it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So I just have a couple clarification. I think it's important to emphasize that we only collect water since lead and copper rule, the compliance point is in the house. We specifically only collect water from homes that's built before 1987. This is a very targeted program, just so that we will only take water from the homes that we know potentially would have an issue. So this issue came out as part of Flint, that they were collecting water from non-compliant or not required homes. So I just want to make sure that it's clear to our customer that we definitely targeted potential homes that potentially we have lead issues that's built prior to 1987. And actually, we have an outreach program. If they choose to collect water for us, we actually have an outreach and a whole packet of educational material as what the rest of the directors are asking, but we'll bring it back in committee and we could talk about this again. But So for now, I would like to open the public hearing. So if any members of the public that wish to address the board on this item, please approach the podium and identify yourself. You each have 5 minutes. Mr. Ramos, I think you're it.
The thing about bringing up, when they put in new water heater, well, last year I put a new water heater in. And there was quite a bit to it. I didn't want to do it myself. I did it way back in the 90s, but I'm not strong enough anymore. But anyway, I went to the city and they gave me a permit and so forth, and I hired a plumber. And when the inspection came, they said, do you have a CO2
carbon monoxide detector,
Smoke detectors, and what's that got to do with my water? And now they're going to be inspecting for other things, like do I have lead in my pipes or whatever. And, you know, this thing about the lumber companies or the hardware companies selling equipment. Guy had to go out and buy new, because I had old shut-off valves and what have you. They had to have that special. Mm-hmm. Well, my bill started kind of low, and I thought, hey, that's pretty good, you know, not too bad. And by the time you got on there, I had $1,500 worth of damages in there because of all these different things that are being required.
And then I had to go buy smoke detectors to put in each bedroom because the ones in the hall weren't good enough. Or they were working, but they had to be in the bedrooms. Okay, it's a safety issue. Fine. But the thing is, you know, if you start requiring these other things, where are we going to get at? Join this 21st century, but it's getting harder. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to comment? No? With that, then I will close the public hearing. Let's see, does the directors have any additional questions or comments for staff?
No.
No?
No.
Okay. I think that's it. Right, because there's no action. Thank you very much, Ms. Ha.
I think the recommendation is for the board to receive the report.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
I think I have to abstain on the next one.
Right, so next item is item 5.3, authorization of professional services agreement for the Iron Horse Lane Water Main Replacement Project. Before we proceed with this, I believe Director Wee has something to say.
Yes, there's a requirement that if you have a property interest, real property interest within 500 feet of a project, you it's presumed that you will have a conflict. I have an easement for a driveway, which is about 400 feet from the project area, so I will excuse myself. Thank you.
All right, now that Director Wee has left the room, let's start on item 5.3.
Yes, and this item involves a professional services agreement for Iron Horse Lane main replacement project and will be presented by Mr. Stevenson, Manager of Engineering and Technology Services, this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Shaver, and good evening. Construction of the Iron Horse Lane Water Main Replacement Project is anticipated to commence in August 2016. Inspection services are required during construction to monitor and support construction activities for this unique water system replacement project. This project is partially funded from the 2015 Water System Revenue Bond proceeds, and there's adequate funding in the current fiscal year capital budget for this expenditure. And I'll just remind the board, this is the project that's going to replace the water system in the Iron Horse Lane in Niles. And this is a very narrow work area with improvements and fences and buildings and, you know, homes and businesses immediately adjacent to the work area. And we need to make sure that we've got a, you know, safe environment for the public and access for the public through the area. And we want to have a consistent district presence on site. The district has two construction inspectors on staff, and they can inspect all of the capital improvement program projects and development projects. And so they wouldn't be available to dedicate the time needed to do inspection on the project. So hence the request for outside services. So our recommendation is by motion authorize the general manager to execute a professional services agreement with Park Engineering Incorporated in an amount not to exceed $87,460 for construction inspection services associated with the Iron Horse Lane Water Main Replacement Project, job 21038. And also just late breaking news, Assistant District Secretary is passing out from some information about a invitation to a community tent event that the district is hosting on next week, next Wednesday, August 17th, between 5 and 7 p.m. Out there at Niles. So this is where we'll erect our little pop-up shade and entertain questions from the public, inform folks as to what's happening. We've sent about 180 invitations in the materials that you're looking at to homes and businesses in the vicinity of the project. And also communicated directly with the Niles Merchants Association and the Niles Main Street Association and Niles Yahoo Users Group, and posted the information on our website. So I wanted to make sure that you're aware of that event coming up next week. And I'll be happy to address any questions.
Any questions from the directors? Director?
I have none.
Director Koller?
Yes. Can you tell me what the existing meter sizes are to these laterals? Is you're changing all the laterals to an inch and a half? And,
yeah.
And is that going to raise their water rates?
It's a good question. There are varying meter sizes out there. They're mostly small.
Mm-hmm.
The service lateral sizes we're putting in are our standard laterals for single family homes for new construction. So we're putting in a new water main, new water system. So this is our standard lateral size. There would be no impact to their costs, bimonthly service charges or anything like that. The lateral itself is just the pipe that connects the water main to the meter, and the meters wouldn't be changing as a result of the project.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions, Director Gunther?
No, not really a question, comment. Having dealt with ships built in the 1940s with drawings that weren't updated past the 1950s, trying to repair those in the 1980s was a significantly difficult task, and you could see the pipes. I hope the public understands the difficulty of what we're about to go into here, and thank goodness it's only in a few rather historic areas of the district, I believe. I'd be curious if we know of any other locations in Newark or possibly Union City areas that may possess situations like this in Niles. This is pretty unique.
Certainly one of the older parts of our current water service area, and as we've discussed in the past, the water system that's there now was not installed by the district. It long predates the district, and in fact it's actually unclear as to who installed the water system that's there now. And I think Director Seth even mentioned that it might even have been Shin, who had interest in water, providing water service back in the day. So this is a very, very old water system. We've done a lot of investigatory work out there, potholing it, but we do recognize that there's still a lot of mysteries buried under the ground, and that's one of the reasons we do want to have an inspector on site monitoring things, because we do expect to run into some unforeseen conflicts and other issues.
Well, certainly if Director Shin was involved, then hopefully we're going to be just fine.
All right. With that, do I have a motion?
I'll move staff recommendation.
I'd love to second that.
Okay.
Mr. Waring?
Sure. Directors Weed, Gunther?
Aye.
Koller?
Aye.
Sethy?
Aye.
And Huang?
Aye. With that, would someone please go and retrieve Director Weed?
Got him?
Yes. Okay, that's fine. All right, so now that Director Weed is back, my apologies, directors. We need to revisit item 5.2. I actually need a motion and a second and a vote to accept staff, to receive staff report.
I'll move to accept staff's recommendations on 5.2.
I think it's a receipt of a report.
Yes.
The recommendation is to receive a report.
Okay. I'll second the recommendation to receive the report.
Mr. Warren?
Sure. Directors Weed?
Aye.
Aye.
Koller?
Aye.
Sethy?
Aye.
And Huang?
Aye. All right. Now that we buttoned that one up, let's move on to item 5.4, please.
So item 5.4 concerns resolutions concurring with the petition for annexation of territory, agreeing to an exchange of property tax revenues, and consenting to annexation of district property. This would be annexation number 109, Sabercat Road, Osgood Road, Durham Road, and the I-680 corridor. And this item will again be presented by Mr. Stevenson.
Indeed. The district and the Alameda County Local Agency Formation Commission, LAFCO, have received separate annexation requests by the owners of two separate parcels in the vicinity of Sabercat Road, Osgood Road, and Durham Road along the I-680 corridor in Fremont. The properties are currently part of an island of unannexed territory along the I-680 corridor between Durham Road and south of Washington Boulevard. LAFCO has requested that the district provide assistance in the preparation of a single annexation that would eliminate the island by annexing the two subject properties as well as all other properties within the island. That would be what constitutes annexation number 109 for the district. In order to complete the annexation, the district would need to concur with the annexation proposal and agree to the apportionment of resulting property tax revenues. In addition, as the owner of one of the unannexed parcels within the island, it's a portion of the district Middlefield Reservoir property, the district would need to consent to the annexation of that parcel. The total area to be annexed is approximately 117 acres. This item was reviewed by the Engineering and Information Technology Committee on July 21, 2016. So staff's recommendation is by motion, one, adopt a resolution concurring with annexation number 109, two, adopt a resolution agreeing to the exchange of incremental property tax revenues as a result of territory being annexed to the district, and three, adopt a resolution consenting to the annexation of district property. That's assessor's parcel number 525-0375-00102. And to help illustrate what's being proposed, we have a map on the overhead. Apologize, it's not larger, but it's kind of a large area, so it's kind of a large scale map. But what we can see here is if we look at the screen, I'll do my best to kind of highlight things. This is I-680. This is Automobile Parkway and Durham Road. This is Pine Street here, so you can see the I-680 corridor. And as it turns to go east toward Pleasanton, we can kind of just see it underneath the annexation area here. Osgood Road is here, and we can see the Sabercat development area up here and so forth up in the hills. So the area that's shaded and outlined in red is the area of the proposed annexation. The two properties that have requested annexation to the district are shown here in yellow at the more southern end of the area. One on Osgood Road. This property is currently mostly vacant, and the owner is preparing the property for sale and wants to ensure that it's within the Alameda County Water District boundaries. And then the other property that's requested annexation is over here. That is a property that's being prepared for development. And again, they've requested to be included into the Alameda County Water District's boundary. In various coordination discussions with LAFCO, LAFCO has requested that these two entities who have both requested annexation team up and submit a single application, but that also includes the entire area within our boundary. So this is kind of an anomaly in our service area. This shape area is actually not within our boundary currently. And it's what LAFCO considers to be an island of unannexed territory. So LAFCO is, by their policies, they would like to have these islands eliminated. So one other feature is way up here in the top, there's a green parcel. This is a piece of ACWD's Middlefield Reservoir property. It's actually just outside our service area, as you can see. But since we're one of the property owners within the proposed annexation area, we would have one additional step to take, and that's the third resolution that I described, having to do with consent to the annexation of our own property as part of this overall application. So I hope I've provided some additional information. I'd be happy to address any questions that you have.
Questions from the board?
I just have a single question. Can you clarify what the terms of the exchange on property tax revenues would be?
Sure.
Who's exchanging with whom, and what are we giving up, what are they giving up or gaining?
Sure, I can do my best.
Okay.
So this is an agreement that essentially provides for ACWD, which has no part currently in the property tax, in the ad valorem property tax mix, to be then inserted into that ad valorem mix. In order to be inserted, everybody else has to kind of move over a little bit, right? We're kind of creating another slice of pie, so now we have to reconfigure the pie. The law says that school districts cannot take a reduced share. So the school districts already have a slice of the pie. Their pie cannot get any smaller. So that means everybody else has to take a little bit less. This agreement says that ACWD will take 10% less, essentially, of what we would have taken or what we would be collecting in a similar tax rate area. And then the other entities within the ad valorem mix will also take a reduction in order such that the school district share remains the same. The actual percentages of the other agencies is very difficult to try and confirm in advance. It's kind of an interesting process, but it depends on their existing share, and there's multiple tax rate areas throughout this annexation area. So it depends on their existing share, and it also depends on what tax rate area the county controller will ultimately decide ought to be applied to this area, and some other factors too. So it's pretty difficult to try and estimate. We've estimated our own impact as a result of the 10% reduction or the 90% share to be on the order of a couple of $100 annually. Mm-hmm. Across the entire area. Of course, that's according to current valuation. When the property values increase, our share would, or our amount would increase as well.
And just to clarify it for our audience, we have multiple agencies that you're talking about here with interest in this island. School district, City of Fremont, PG&E maybe?
PG&E doesn't have an ad valorem line item, but there are multiple mosquito abatement districts.
Yeah,
there are multiple entities.
Yeah, I was thinking of the PG&E gas line that runs in through that area.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, we do have multiple governmental agencies that are involved there. That's it.
Director Koller?
I have no comments other than this was reviewed in the engineering committee meeting, and it has some benefits to the district to be annexed based on the mains that will be tied and coupled together. So it has a beneficial use for our water supply.
Director Gunther.
Yeah, I've had the opportunity to see this in committee. It was a fascinating project. I thought of another question I would like to ask, however, those. Do we have an approximate idea of how many other islands are out there?
Sure. Yeah, this one here is the biggest and baddest, most glaring island in ours. It's right in the middle of a, you know, relatively urbanized area. We have two other islands. One, there's a relatively large island. I don't recall the acreage off the top of my head, but it's up in the hills in the southern part of our area, up in East Bay Regional Park District area. Very unlikely that that will ever develop,
okay.
Require water service from the district. That island may be there for a while. There's also a very, very small island up in the Tamarack Knolls area. Again, undeveloped lot or lots, and it's that one may go someday, but it's a very, very small island. LAFCO is interested in getting rid of all of them. The last island we got rid of was in 2011. That was the BART station along Warm Springs.
So we pretty much wiped them all out. Okay,
mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Director Wee?
Yes, I sent a note when I first saw this on email noting the extraordinary challenges for this site with given the presence of the Hayward Fault and its multiple splays and parallel runs. There may be a reason this was an island originally. No one wanted to get near it. I support the idea of closing off all the islands and incorporating them into the system. And also recall the issues we had with Sabercat Court, which we declined to bring into the district when it was first developed, and had a private water system, which we have subsequently taken over, but it had its own personal challenges.
It still has challenges, Director Weed. We have not taken over the water system.
Well,
we've assisted them on many occasions, but we've not taken ownership or anything like that.
So we have systems within our boundaries that are not our system still.
Yes, that's a unique situation up there. But there are lots of private water systems around, mobile home parks and many commercial areas. But for a single family development like that, it's unusual for us.
And as part of this, as we take on everything, will that become part of the a benefit of this effort?
It wouldn't result from this action. We did look at that a number of years ago. And in fact, I had just spoken with one of the residents recently surrounding this annexation. So this annexation action would not resolve that issue. There'd be a lot of infrastructure issues that would have to be dealt with. It does allow for the public water system to be extended much closer to them, but it doesn't resolve all their issues.
Okay, because they had a pipe that went across the ravine that was, and it crossed the island.
Right.
So this may help in at least in that area.
It helps to pave the way, but it wouldn't solve all the problems.
I understand. Thank you.
All right. With that, do I have a motion and a second from the directors?
I'll move staff recommendation.
So
I'll second the motion.
A motion from Director Gunther and a second from Director Koller.
Okay.
Mr. Warren?
Sure. Directors Weed?
Aye.
Gunther?
Aye.
Koller?
Aye.
Sethy?
Aye.
And Huang?
Aye. With that, let's move on to item 5.5.
Thank you, Madam President. Item 5.5 involves a resolution adopting board rules and code of conduct. At the suggestion of the board president, staff and legal counsel have been working over the past several months with the board to comprehensively update the existing rules of the board. And for background, just to review, on April 25th, 2016, the board reviewed the existing rules of the board, evaluated potential revisions to guide board members in their conduct and actions, and provided input to staff and legal counsel. And I believe Mr. Lamos was there for that meeting. Accordingly, staff and legal counsel incorporated the board's input and presented a draft board rules and code of conduct document to the board on June 30th and received more feedback. Since June 30th, staff and legal counsel made further revisions to incorporate the board's input and shared the revised draft document with the board president and vice president for initial feedback and comments. Staff and legal counsel believe that we're close and that the document may now be considered for board adoption. There's a red line version of the document in your board packet, and I suggest that we work from that red line version in this meeting this evening, should you care to provide additional comments and feedback. And I also think we might be having a discussion on section 14, which involves restrictions on board members traveling together, as I believe Director Weed provided input at our last meeting about that issue. And just to basically review why we're doing this for members of the public, what the new proposed document does is, in addition to the material covered by the rules of the board, which is a requirement, the document was substantially broadened to meet several objectives. And there's a number of them, but primarily, in my view, it's so that the board could be transparent and accountable to the people of the district, because it lays everything out pretty clearly, and create a go-to comprehensive reference document for the board, staff, legal counsel, and members of the public for key ACWD board-related policies and practices. And then, by reference, it incorporates key board-adopted policies and procedures related to the board's roles in the governance of the district. So the recommendation this evening is to discuss the draft board rules and code of conduct, and hopefully, by resolution, adopt the board rules and code of conduct.
All right, with that, any directors have any comments, questions on the red line version?
I'll start off with some short comments. First of all, I want to compliment our board president for taking the leadership role on wanting to get this done during her term as board president. Staff has done a really good job too. Our legal counsel, Mr. Miyake, has done a very good job as well working with our general manager. I'm actually pretty comfortable, having gone through this about a dozen times, adopting it as is with the changes, except for the section 14 that the Director Weed has brought up. I would feel more comfortable with a less restrictive policy on the board in terms of travel.
Okay.
But so I will see what the other board members think. I'm ready to compromise on that.
Okay, because I was just going to suggest that it seems like we have consensus on all the changes except that one particular item, so why don't we just focus on that one item if the rest of the directors would agree.
Yeah, so I have no further comments. I'm
okay.
Ready to adopt the all the changes.
Except item
14.
14.
Okay, Director Koller?
Same as the Director Sethy. I'm not going to take it any further.
All right, Director Gunther.
I'm with Director Sethy on this. I'm not overly crazy about item number 14. I think it's a valid suggestion. I don't know if it needs to be as restrictive.
Okay, Director Wee.
My recommendation is to delete item 14. I can go into why, but primarily it was started off as safety, then it got involved in the Brown Act. It's superfluous. We have other provisions that discuss Brown Act, and the safety issue, I think, was a canard. So I'd like to simply delete it.
Okay. Well, I could definitely count four, which is greater than three. So I'm just going to let it be. And, of course, I would like item 14 to be in, as I expressed it last month. But seeing that the majority of board choose to, well, prefer not to have item 14, I would ask if a director would like to make a recommendation to accept, to adopt the board rules as proposed with the deletion of item 14.
I will make that motion. I move to adopt the board recommendation, board rules as promoted, as presented,
Without. With
the deletion of item 14.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
So, Director Weed made the motion. Director Sethy, second. Mr. Warren?
Okay. Director Weed?
Aye.
Gunther?
Considering this is a living document, aye.
Koller?
Aye.
Sethy?
Aye.
And Huang?
Aye. All right.
Yay!
Yay, we're done. After how many months?
So, just for clarification,
okay.
This was adopted by resolution. We did make a change to delete section 14, so the resolution is adopted, and the version of the board rules and code of conduct that will be attached will be the version without section 14, just for pure clarification for the record.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
So let's move on to item 6.1, board committee reports. Does any of the directors have questions or comments on any of the 6.1 committee reports?
I have a couple of quick ones, if I may.
Yes, Director Sethy.
In reading over the engineering and technology services meeting, I think there's a minor correction needed to the minutes where it talks about the division of safety and dams, which reservoirs they cover, and I think from having gone out there a few times now with Mr. Stevens and Mr. Peterson, I believe that Mayhew Reservoir needs to be included in that.
Very perceptive. Mayhew Reservoir was once under the jurisdiction of the Division of Safety of Dams. It no longer is. So that's the current list.
Okay. Last I was out there, I thought it was. I thought that's why we had some concern about the development of the property right below the reservoir.
We monitor that embankment as though it still were within jurisdiction. It's mm-hmm. something that we are very careful to keep an eye on. And, of course, we're very interested in all the activities around the property, including development nearby.
Well, that leads me to a follow-up question. Why has it been dropped from their list when it's a hillside property and a quake zone and all those
sure.
other factors?
A number of years ago, we reduced the operating level of the reservoir by installing a new spillway at a lower elevation. And when we did that, we reduced the total amount of water that's impounded and reduced it to below Division of Safety of Dam standards. And so they removed us from jurisdiction.
All right, great. Okay. Second is a comment on our water sales, our water production. It looks like June, July, and August are we've gotten our water sales back up. That's good for our revenues and good for the health of the district. And then lastly, on the hardness report, I've noticed in the last two reports the softness of the water in the southern half of our service area. And I'm wondering, why is it so soft? Are we distributing more Hetch Hetchy water into the system?
That's a great question. I'm impressed that you are that observant of the graph. And yes, we have a great explanation for it. The water that we're receiving from the Delta, the hardness has dropped significantly, and that is what you're seeing on the graph is the area influenced by water treatment plant number two. So that's surface water that has softened up as a result of softer water coming from the Delta.
That's interesting to learn because I was wondering if we were getting Delta water or more Hetch Hetchy water in the system. So
we're actually getting, currently we have TP2 at our highest nominal rate at 26 MGD. And that's, of course, influencing its area of influence, and that's Delta water.
That's good to hear. That must mean we've got a nice snowpack melting down into the Delta there.
Well, that's I would let my colleague, Mr. N, address those types of questions.
Yeah. Thank you very much. That's it.
Director Koller?
No comments.
Director Gunther?
I'm good.
Director Weed.
Yes, on the Finance and Outreach Committee meeting, it's noted in our minutes that we had a discussion on the financial planning model and update, and that we had a discussion also related to the discount rate for required for various scenarios on our to cover our legacy cost. Part of that discussion was a suggestion that we reduce the discount rate to 6%, which would meet the Moody's model and a 20-year payoff, which would meet the Moody's criteria for a stress test to AAA. The investments results this year were particularly poor. It came in at 0.4% for CalPERS and 1.04% for the OPEB Seabird. That's almost a 7% miss on almost $150 million in investments, a $10 million hit net present value. We're looking at $160 million, at 6%, we're looking at about $160 million now, another $170 million net present value unfunded, more than six times our annual payroll. We hopefully will be able to address that in the coming months and look at the need to increase the annual retirement contribution, required contribution, the ARC, plus whatever other monies are necessary to meet a 2038 deadline. That'll require a significant increase in our payments over and above what we discussed and discontinued several years ago during the drought. And these numbers are growing, and they're growing dramatically. It's a major issue for us.
All right. With that, let's move on to item 6.2, operational reports. Any comments from the directors? No?
No.
Seeing none, let's move on to item 6.3, staff presentations. Oh, Mr. Ramos. Yes. Of course. Please approach the podium. My apologies.
Greg Lemus calling again. Mr. Weed's comments on brought up something that I saw in the newspaper about CalPERS. And since I think in one of the meetings you joined CalPERS for your employees or whatever, and the article says that they were underfunded by 40% or 60%, somewhere in there.
We're more.
Pardon?
We're more than the CalPERS average.
Well, the thing was that the taxpayers will have to make up the difference. And that was my main point, is that, you know, a lot of times, Mr. Weed, you talk about underfunding. I'm underfunded, you know, as a taxpayer. I don't know what I'm going to do in the next 20 years if I got it. And with all these different things that are coming up, like taxes, you know, USD just jacked their price up, and they said they're gonna jack it up for the next 5 years. And well, my comment was that you know, we're gonna start paying more money for our service employees, like police and firemen. I don't mind it, but it's just that when my water company is in there, it, you know, it just kind of makes me wonder who else is going to try to pick my pocket. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michelle.
I'm going to be leaving because I want to address the Newark board, and it's not in protest of anything, so, but thank you.
Thank you for coming, Mr. Lamos. All right, with that, let's move on to item 6.3.1, California Water Fix Update.
Thank you, President Huang. This evening, we continue our series of updates on the district's potential water supply initiatives, and I'll pass it on to Mr. Rin, who will likely pass it on to Thomas Neiser, as is customary.
Thank you, Mr. Shaver. I actually have a couple items to share first. Beginning in February of this year, we started the process of providing monthly updates to the board on the California Water Fix. We spent the first 4 months reviewing the project, the schedule, the plan for evaluating California Water Fix, and other water supply reliability concepts selected by the board. Over the last 2 months, we provided the board with an evaluation of a few of these other water supply reliability concepts, such as indirect potable reuse, Los Vaqueros expansion, and Sites Reservoir. Prior to tonight's presentation, I would like to provide the board with a brief update on the Los Vaqueros Reservoir expansion project. The Contra Costa Water District is in the process of developing local agency funding agreements for those agencies interested in providing funding for planning studies to evaluate the potential benefits of the project and to prepare an application for Proposition 1 grant funding. The local water agencies participating in the studies and considering $100,000 contributions include Alameda County Water District, the Bay Area Water Supply Conservation Agency, Byron Bethany Irrigation District, the City of Brentwood, East Bay Municipal Utility District, East Contra Costa Irrigation District, San Francisco Public Utilities Commission, San Luis Delta Mendota Water Authority, Santa Clara Water District, Santa Clara Valley Water District, and Zone 7 Water Agency. Local agency participation in this stage of the project preserves the option for participating in project implementation. We plan to bring the funding agreement to the board for your consideration at a future board meeting. So getting back to this month's presentation, Thomas Neiser is back again with us again to provide evaluating another water supply reliability concept, the Bay Desalination. Before he speaks, I did forget to introduce someone that's in the audience, a special invitee as a result of Thomas, and her name is Megan Marino.
You want to wave to the board? Mm-hmm. She's temporary staff helping out our conservation group during these busy months. So with that, I'll turn it over to Thomas.
Great, thank you. And I would like to correct, Megan actually asked if she could attend out of interest in the industry and the board, so I was not inviting her and forcing her to be here. She's here on her own genuine interest as a member of the public and a young professional in the industry. So thank you for having us back here, another thrilling installment of the California Water Fix business case. For the benefit of the audience, there's a fair amount of additional background information that's been shared over the months. I think, Ms. Wright, you've been here for quite a bit. I'm going to skip over some of the background material so we can keep this tight. But please, if there's anything that you don't understand or have a question about, feel free to ask, and I'll slow down and provide some further background. As a brief background, the Alameda County Water District is a member of the State Water Project, is participating in an evaluation of the Water Fix, which is the Delta solution or the Twin Tunnels. The board, well, the process is such that the individual contract agencies, including ACWD, will have an opportunity to either opt in or opt out of the Delta solution or Twin Tunnels. And a decision is expected from our board, the opportunity to opt in, opt out, currently still slated for next month. However, all indication is that date will continue to slip. However, we are still shooting for a full analysis of the Water Fix and its value to us by September, such that we can be on track should it follow with the scheduled date. As a reminder, the Delta solution, the Water Fix, as proposed to the district, would provide ACWD a difference between a improved Delta conveyance facility and a potential future worst case if no tunnels were to be built or solution of about 6.6 thousand acre feet per year. And that worst case scenario we refer to as ECHO, existing conditions high outflow. I'll use that term ECHO for the rest of the presentation. The district's estimated contribution to this project is $106 million. And ACWD, the direction of the board, staff has been evaluating this Water Fix as, from a business case perspective. What does this actually do for us? What's it worth? Could we do something more productive with that same amount of money? At the direction of the board, we've been evaluating a number of alternative scenarios. Tonight, we're here to present some results from an analysis of the Bay desalination concept. And we'll just point out on this list that we've added the additional items which have come up since we started the process. The board initially gave us desalination, indirect potable reuse, and Los Vaqueros.
May I suggest the Del Valle might be South Bay Aqueduct Extension? Is that in there in the
fine print? We've sort of got that ambiguously all under Lake Del Valle storage expansion.
Oh, okay, thank
you.
I see it now. Folks.
It's kind of not a well-defined concept, so it appears that way.
No, it's fine. No, I didn't. Oh, I see. I see.
At this point.
We have metaphoric fonts here.
Yes.
Thomas, can you give us a total cost of Bay Desal? You have the 48 million gallons per day, but what's the cost?
We're going to get there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's okay. The grand finale of this one. Okay, 48 MGD, by the way, refers to the average daily demand at build out. Once all of the Tri-City has been built out, our current planned total future demand in roughly 30 years' time is about 48 million gallons per day average daily demand. So that's what that refers to. You'll note we have 43 and 48, 43 being a near-term post-drought demand.
Okay. Well, we have that chart up on that last one, which is Del Valle, which I like. Thank you. The extension of the South Bay Aqueduct directly to the pits is something hopefully we can incorporate in some of our studies at some point, and maybe in part incorporate in the Water Fix eventually. The Water Fix is going to be delayed with legislation for another 10 years, which gives us some adequate time to introduce yet additional, not legislation, excuse me, litigation, with litigation. And therefore,
working with Del Valle, the ability to have year-round direct deliveries is extraordinary opportunity. Thank you.
Potentially so. Thank you. We'll take that into consideration. This month, the August update on the water fix business case, the local bay desalination concept, specifically the scenario that was identified as the most favorable scenario in the 2014 RMC study, water supply alternative study. Specifically, this was option A to B. And before I go with here, a lot of this is going to be about the cost of this particular scenario. It was a very costly scenario, as the board was apprised of in 2014. In particular, in direct comparison to the sort of the measuring stick we have in the Bay Area right now, which is the regional desal facility concept, right, which was also considered in that 2014 study. So I want to take just a little bit, maybe one slide, to explain why regional desal is so cost effective, so that the sticker shock on our desal facility at least makes a little bit of sense. But notably, the total unit cost for these two projects is a factor of three difference. Our local desal came in at about $4,700 an acre foot, more than two times San Francisco's build out post-WISA price, whereas the regional desal is around $1,500. So just to explain a little bit about regional desal, these aren't apples and apples in this case. So just hitting the highlights, the thing about the regional desal that are really important, I'll express right here, it's a lot of cost efficiencies that are built into this project. It starts with, well, let me point out that it's just a concept, it doesn't exist, but it would be located on Sassoon Bay at Mallard Slough, an existing intake from Contra Costa Water District. The reasons why regional desal is so cost effective are many. It starts with we had a 13 alternatives analysis. This was by far the best single scenario out of those 13. It's a 20 MGD facility with five member agencies. It has economy of scale built into it. But the biggies are really that it has an existing intake and a water right, Contra Costa Water Districts, Mallard Slough, they have water rights. They don't exercise that because the water's a little bit too salty. Not great to drink, but possibly good for a desalination facility. Another big thing is the brine discharge. And now, in the state of California, brine discharge for a desal facility basically has to go along with an existing sanitation outfall. Wastewater facilities have fresh water, in that it's very low salinity, when they're outfall to the ocean, mixing some raw brine discharge from a desal plant actually has an environmental benefit for it. Straight brine discharge to any water body is basically too toxic in salt levels to even entertain getting a NPDES permit for. One of the benefits of the regional desal concept is that there's a wastewater treatment plant and an existing discharge right almost adjacent to the site. It's also close to a PG&E power plant, reducing costs. But a big factor is that this location in Sassoon Bay is frequently near fresh. So the salinity varies annually, but even in its worst, it's about half of bay level salinity. It is at its freshest time of year when there's heavy freshwater outflows in the delta, there's about 1,000 ppm salt. In the winter and fall, when there's minimal freshwater coming in, you have a lot of bay water moving in that direction, it's 12,000 ppm. And for reference, that's roughly half of what we're contemplating for a bay desalination facility. That directly translates into energy, pump sizing and energy. So there's just dollars, straight dollars. So by comparison, a little background of why the regional desal facility's got some perks. The concept which was presented by RMC as the best solution for ACWD, at the time we were looking at an alternative to State Water Project water, we had identified the need to have that source water be entered into the Warm Springs area, as Mr. Peterson mentioned earlier. Down here, that's where treatment plant 2 water comes in, and this way we would be directly offsetting State Water Project supplies in the scenario where we don't invest in the delta. And what that means is we need to get rid of our brine through the most available discharge location, which is the EBDA outfall. So we would need to build a brine line, and we looked at, so this line takes brine discharge from that southerly location all the way up to basically USD. Now alternatively, we could put the plant up by USD, modify our distribution system to move the product water south, For reasons I don't remember exactly, this was the preferred scenario, which I presume means the cheapest. There may be some land availability issues along with that decision. But it was one way or the other. We build a pipe to take brine up, or we build greater piping to bring fresh water south. The other issue, though, is that the EBDA outfall is seasonally challenged. Its availability in the winter months is non-existent. It's filled with stormwater. So in this scenario, unless we were to do something like an IPR project, such as was evaluated as the scenario where we would get completely off the state water project, we're not benefiting USD, and we certainly don't want to impact them. So we'd only really be able to operate a facility during the drier months of the year, 8 months of the year, when there's spare capacity in the EBDA outfall. And that has a direct translation into the size of this plant. Now, basically, you need to build a bigger plant that can make that same volume of water in a shorter amount of time. So the scenario considered a 22 MGD facility would produce 11 MGD of permeate, with really an objective of producing equivalent of about a 7.5 MGD annual production rate, or 8,000 acre feet. Now, at the time, 8,000 was what we thought we would be losing if we don't invest in the tunnels. That number is now 6.6. We have a little bit of disconnect. We weren't going to go back and reevaluate all of RMC's costing numbers, so we just went ahead and evaluated an 8,000 acre foot per year plant. And a major thing about this location versus, say, the regional desal is that we would use what are called slant wells as intakes for the water. Rather than building a fish screen protection in a highly corrosive environment such as the bay, the objective would be to drill wells directly beneath the bay floor that would use basically the floor of the bay as a filtration to prevent entrainment of any fish species, aquatic species.
Are you still talking about, I'm a little confused on that,
mm-hmm.
That would be up at Mallard?
No, this is now ACWD.
Oh, this is the ACWD.
This was the best bay desalination concept that RMC scoped in that study. They had three desal concepts. One of them was actually buy into regional desal,
mm-hmm.
and then two alternatives. This was the preferred of the two that they studied for a local ACWD owned and operated full control bay desalination plant. So the takeaway is that this whole concept is discharge constrained, and there's a steep cost sensitivity based on that. First, we have to build a brine line, which is very expensive, but also that seasonal operation, compressing an annual need of volume of water into only 8 months means we have to substantially increase the size of the plant as well as the slant wells, which are individually quite pricey. So roughly 50% increased capital cost just for those facilities to work in that smaller time frame. So when we put a direct comparison to the bay, the regional desal and ACWD concept specifically, you'll see whereas the total capital cost for regional desal, because there are so many existing facilities out there, $273 million, ACWD's estimate was $464 million, and you'll note that roughly half of that total cost is just these site-specific requirements of slant wells and brine handling the brine. And then when we look at the rolled-up unit costs, combine the annual capital amortization cost plus the O&M costs, you see that ours is quite a bit higher, double that of regional desal. That's salt. That's that more than two times salinity factor. Just power. So that explains the difference in those price. With that, we will jump in. Well, if there are any questions comparing our concept to that of the regional desal, I'll jump straight into our modeling analysis.
I think Director Wee has a question.
I fail to see the conceptual difference between our current brackish groundwater desal and taking groundwater from underneath the bay, except for the location and the dramatic decrease in salinity. So might we look in, if we're looking at our own desal capabilities, the ability to expand our current brackish groundwater desal and see if there isn't an opportunity to take even more water and produce it at $500 or $800 an acre foot as opposed to $5,000 an acre foot, a tenfold difference in price.
Yeah, absolutely. The difference is very simple. The sustainable yield of the groundwater basin is limited. So our production at the existing desal facility is based on our ability to backfill the aquifer with fresh water and keep it at a low salinity versus this scenario, which is not tapping into our fresh water supply, pulling simply from the bay. But the Newark desalination facility simply requires more recharge water. So under the IPR scenario, where we created a new source of recharge to put in the basin, and then we can simply increase desal production quite easily.
Or we increase our ability to bring in water through the state project. It doesn't have to be state water, if through the South Bay Aqueduct and extension directly to our pits.
Absolutely. If we can have another source of reliable recharge water, we could certainly improve the annual yield from our desal facility.
Thank you.
I knew that was coming.
All right, Thomas, very good. Let's move on.
All right, so modeling analysis. So we run this through our 80-year integrated resources planning model. We find, and again, this is at the 48 MGD, so that's the 2040 build-out conditions. This is an opt-out scenario, so this is the ECHO Lower Reliability State Water Project. We've done desal instead of investing in the delta. We have our 11 MGD facility that's only run for 8 months out of the year. In addition to the capital cost for desal, as was presented with the IPR scenario, we still have a few other distribution system enhancements that would be needed. This is if we are not relying as much on surface water treatment, we would still need to make these upper zone improvements that were presented last month. That number is going to go up when we have some refinements coming in the next month. Same information that was shared with IPR. As you can see, it's pennies on the dollar compared to the capital cost of the desal facility. But that total cost goes up to about $480 million. Our modeling results show absolutely wonderful results as far as reliability. It is a very highly reliable alternative, partly because we modeled a little bit more than we've given up in state water supply, but really because it's a drought-proof supply, that 8,000 acre-feet is available in all years. The tunnels are not going to improve dry year reliability. When there's no water on the state, it doesn't matter whether you got tunnels or no tunnels, there's nothing to deliver, whereas that desal facility would be there in all years. So we see good reliability results. We see no change in the SFPUC purchases in the future, so our background operating costs remain quite high, because all we've done is we've offset the cost, the volume of water that we expect from the state water project. Our groundwater conditions in semi-tropic look very healthy. It would be a very robust, reliable system indeed. However, the cost results are certainly where you'll see that. These are the monthly results from the past scenarios which the board has seen. I'm just going to pause here for a moment. We had a combination of our net capital costs for the scenario, so the annual cost to amortize those, and then the expected annual operating costs, water supply, power, chemicals, just the variable stuff. For this scenario, it's quite staggering. The rolled up total annual operating cost, the marginal cost to operate plus the capitalization, roughly double what we would expect from a baseline scenario, close to double that of a water fix scenario. But the results, as the board is well aware, are not just about the cost. The other scenario, the other indicators that we've been looking at are water quality, local control, seismic resilience, and reliability shortages. And a bay desal is certainly the best in all of these metrics. The water quality is excellent. The local control, it's 100% an ACWD controlled facility, presuming the regulatory agencies are not overbearing. The resilience, we assume it would be built to modern seismic codes and would be as reliable as anything built today with new standards. And the shortages, we show one shortage out of 80 years of 7%, which is really phenomenal. It's effectively 0%, zero shortages over 80 years. So droughts, middle, medium years, all year types, it's effectively no shortages, but at a very high cost. A question.
I do not see a column or a point that says this is new water, as opposed to the water fix, which is no new water.
We can add, that's certainly a good, on our list, we recall we were adding climate change, a few other indicators that are not on this list. Certainly new water is a
really
check.
Important element.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So a few things about the, come the end of the, this study, when we have our workshop in October, the board will see all this rolled up, but I think it's obviously some fairly stark results at this point. There are some, as I mentioned, the discharge element is a hypersensitive assumption. It's not a linear, it's a compounding assumption there. So there's a few things, and it could go either way. One thing that could substantially lower the cost would be if we found an alternative location to discharge the brine. We've had some discussions regarding some salt ponds that may actually be able to receive some brine. I don't know what volume. This is still very preliminary discussions. So we're going to continue to investigate these scenarios. There's also the question of there's a substantial amount of fresh water in the winter. Perhaps we could build a smaller plant and find some way to mix the brine discharge with fresh storm water and discharge it directly into the South Bay. Could reduce the plant size. Could be a more cost-effective scenario. Alternatively, we could go the other way. The biggest concern are the slant wells I mentioned. The South Bay, the floor of the bay is known as bay mud. It's like clay in permeability. The likelihood that we'd actually be able to pull 22 million gallons a day through the bay muds is very suspect. So there's a big uncertainty there. And the potential restrictions on brine discharge are always there. If we were beholden to USD, EBDA, capacity constraints, at any moment you could substantially lose capacity and seriously affect the cost effectiveness of a scenario like this.
Thomas, I have a question. Isn't there an aquifer below the bay level that extends across the bay from the Niles Cone? So couldn't we draw directly from that underground aquifer well below the bay?
So this is a great question. There's multiple aquifers. In fact, the very aquifers that sit beneath our feet pretty much all run underneath the bay. The shallowest one, the Newark Aquifer, may be saltier, and it's certainly saltier at parts under the bay. Ideally, there would be a sweet spot at some point where you could pump that aquifer and pull more salts from that side and not pull in our fresh water from this side. But it's a real sweet spot. It could help to economize a plant concept like this, and we've looked at that in the past. Thing is it's really far out, and there's not a lot of terra firma on which to build infrastructure to access a point like that, but it's conceptually that may be true. The deeper aquifers are all fresh, and if we hit those, all we're going to do is rob from our own Niles Cone, at our existing well fields.
Okay.
Director Koller?
Yes, you brought up discharge to salt ponds. Have we investigated with Cargill if they could take our brine?
We've spoken with Cargill over the years, and we spoke with them again recently, and we're continuing to talk. They've changed their operations a bit. So far, they've indicated that they're not terribly interested, but it's a topic that's worth keeping alive moving forward, and we'll continue to talk with them, speak with them.
Thank you.
On the discharge, have you looked at the potential for using the ecotone or laid-back levees as a source of discharge for what would give us a long-term permanent agreement for irrigating these levees?
To irrigate with the brine concentrate?
With the discharge or the brine discharge.
Concentrated from this source as a source of irrigation, but the discussions we're having right now are trying to have with Coastal Conservancy regarding some of the salt pond restoration. There are ponds which are deemed too fresh, and there's a possibility there might be locations that would be eligible to receive brine. This is very preliminary information. We don't have any real input on quantities of water, salts, but the objective is to find out where they are, how much salt they can take, what kind of flow rates, and maybe we could scope something, a much smaller facility. But if it could take advantage of something like that, you could potentially build a small new water source, not the size we need here, but at a much more cost-effective price.
Let me encourage you to talk to Oraloma, because we're looking at a remarkably wide spectrum of salinity in the discharges that they're trying to look at various patterns that were in their pilot project.
The wastewater agency.
Yeah, the wastewater agency. They're talking about taking their wastewater and putting it in for irrigation of these levees. But it looks like there may be potential for taking plants that have very high salt tolerance and using that as a discharge point. Because one of the issues we have with our current desal plant is that the brine is so diluted that it's not economically competitive with the ocean, although it may be economically worth our while just to pay the salt companies to take it off our hands.
Moving on.
That's it for the bay desalination concept. Next month, we hope to bring a refinement on Los Vaqueros expansion studies. We brought basic numbers before. That was reflecting our friends' work out there. We're trying to incorporate it into our models and see how it works with the rest of our supplies. We hope to bring that next month.
Now,
it's a lot more complex than this one, though.
Speaking about complex, have we looked at our total cost of our own local desal? And looked at a regional desal and what the total cost of that would be. I'm expecting $1.2 billion for a regional option to take care of the entire East Bay.
Oh, the entire East Bay?
Yes.
Oh, no, I don't know anybody's looked at anything larger. The existing regional desal is a 20 MGD.
20 MGD.
Product, yeah, very small. If you look at the net demands of all the water agencies in the Bay Area, it's kind of a Swiss Army knife concept. Some agencies need wet year water, some need normal year water, and that's how that's going to work, a sharing agreement. But it's very cost effective because of its location. It doesn't include the wheeling of that water, which could easily double that cost if ACWD were to participate. We might pay easily. It's $1,500 an acre foot. We might easily pay $1,500 to wheel that through the various agencies, depending on the terms they set.
Okay, and lastly, has any of the other agencies, are they thinking about opting out of the Bay Delta Fix?
So, to my knowledge, my counterparts at Santa Clara and Zone 7 are doing the same analyses right now. They're trying to work on a business case. Mm-hmm. Those agencies are much more heavily reliant on the Delta.
Yes.
Percentage of a portfolio. So the stakes are very different for both of those agencies. But they are both working on similar alternatives analyses at this time.
Okay. Thank you, Thomas.
Director Gunther?
On the regional, I know we're not really talking about the regional, but are there any expectations, perhaps, of environmental issues on their intake?
Yeah,
being particularly right on the bay?
There are. It is an existing intake. It's an existing water right. It doesn't get a lot of use. And so there's a baseline argument that this would all be kind of new diversion. It's subject, really, Delta smelt and salmonids. It's right on the causeway, particularly for salmonids. So there's a lot of environmental challenge typical to any other Delta intake.
Okay.
Director Wee?
Yes, the intake, Mallard, is that connected by pipelines to the rest of the Contra Costa system?
I believe the intake there, I'm not certain, but I believe it's a canal, largely raw water, that they then transport to the west of their facility. And Director Huang, you're nodding your head, so I think you have some knowledge here.
A long, long time ago, 20 years ago, I used to work out there regulating PG&E's intake. Mm-hmm. So I think Mallard's, the water come in through the intake in Mallard Slough and somehow end up in Contra Costa Canal?
Yeah, it's a raw water canal that runs over to the.
So unfortunately, it's still an open channel.
It would be taken from the slough, treated,
and put into
pressurized pipe.
So you'd have to build a new pipeline. Two quick thoughts. One is the ability to take a scenario with the Del Valle. If we had these up to 77,000 acre feet of to the current Glory Hole and potentially even more of water that's fairly good quality, the ability to take degraded water from the Delta, possibly from Mallard Slough, and blend it at Del Valle and sending it south would be an issue, would be an approach that may not require a discharge permit. We're just taking water with a little higher salinity and blending it partway down as it's being sent down the South Bay Aqueduct. And therefore, clearly expanding our current water supplies. The second is we're looking at eight, and I'm going to go into the LaValle, which is your next line. We obtain 15,000 acre feet of additional water supply if we lower the intake for the 250,000 gallon, a very small water treatment facility the East Bay Regional Park District has at Del Valle. That's twice the amount of water we saw in our shortfall, which we split. That's our share, the 6.6. We achieved the 8,000 acre feet per year in a critical year by merely lowering the, intake for this small water treatment facility the park district has at Del Valle. So that is a nominal cost compared to these other major projects. So I'm encouraging us when we get to Del Valle to look at some of the alternatives that may put all this money, these other issues to rest.
It's a great scenario for the new water column.
Thank you.
So for the Bay D-cell, the regional D-cell, I am a little bit worried about the intake at Mellor Slough. Mm-hmm. So a long time ago, about 20 years ago, when I had PG&E, which is closer to the bay from Mellor Slough's intake, they were definitely taking in Chinook salmon mm-hmm. and what they call the other fish. Big parentheses, and pretty sure there were a lot of delta smelts in that other fish bucket. So they will probably run into the same restriction we have with our delta intake.
Yeah, we expect with the mallard slough, it's a dead-end slough that comes off of the main channel. Most people say they'd probably have to move a screened intake right up to the channel, which will substantially add cost to it. But I will point out that the only regional desal that shows up in any of these analyses is what Contra Costa Water District claims we could get out of a Los Vaqueros expansion. The water supply that was presented, that's new water from Los Vaqueros expansion, is mostly wet year surplus regional desal water. So I hope you will keep these skeptical thoughts about regional desal when we get back to Los Vaqueros.
All right, okay. We'll do that. Any more questions?
No,
okay, with that, then let's move. Thank you very much, Thomas. Look forward to the next installment. So with that, let's move on to item 6.4, General Manager's Report, please.
Yes, thank you, President Huang. I just wanted to point out to the directors that the California Special District Association, CSDA, is requesting interest for participation in committees and expert feedback teams, and you should have received a little package today. Waiting for you. Mr. Rin has a brief report on activities that have been going on recently in Aqua and that the district has been requested to participate in a letter to the governor, and Mr. Rin's going to provide some background information on that issue.
Thank you, Mr. Shaver. In mid-July, the California Natural Resources Agency released the Delta Smelt Resiliency Strategy, which is a science-based document that was prepared to voluntarily address both immediate and near-term needs of Delta Smelt and to promote their resiliency to drought conditions as well as future variations in habitat conditions. Late Tuesday afternoon of this week, the general manager received an email from Aqua requesting that ACWD be a signatory on a letter to the governor that supports the strategy's comprehensive life cycle approach, but does not support one of the 13 proposed actions, which would provide 85,000 to 200,000 acre feet of additional outflows above what is required during the summer, and up to 250,000 acre feet of additional outflow during the spring and summers of 2017 and 2018. Aqua is requesting responses by the end of the day tomorrow. We checked in with our state water contractors, and the contractors are also opposed to the additional outflow requirements of the strategy. In addition, though, there are questions about the entire strategy because of a lack of details for the other proposed actions on things like who will be responsible for carrying out these actions
and what those estimated costs might be. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over to the general manager to talk about potential next steps.
So I just thought it would be beneficial to bring this to the board's attention in case there's any knowledge from the board or any feedback, because essentially Aqua is asking the district to sign on to this letter. The state water contractors have reservations about it. I'm very reluctant to get out in front of the board on this issue when we totally don't understand the entire proposal, which is complex and broad. Should all that be resolved in a way that staff can assure ourselves that the district's interests are being protected and it's in the best interest of the district to sign such a letter, then we would consider doing so. But until then, Aqua is doing a very urgent outreach effort, in terms of who has agreed to sign on to the letter, it's not the usual suspects that share interests with ACWD at this point. So just wanted to make the board aware of this issue. Okay. And that's a good segue, because if this all does get resolved by, say, next week, then Mr. In will be the acting general manager, so he's very familiar with the issue, because I will be out next week. And looking at staff to see if there are any other comments, that's it from the general manager.
All right, then let's move on to item 7.1, report from Director Sethy on the July 21st, 2016 California Water Commission meeting at the State of California Resource Building in Sacramento.
Well, I attended a very, very interesting meeting last month. It was a real eye-opener. My first California Water Commission meeting that I've attended. And it was interesting to experience the fact that I myself personally am part of one body in the water industry, but then I'm looking at a seven-member board representing the entire state of California. And or nine-member board, rather. I'm going to cover a few points here, but if Mr. In wants to interject at any point to clarify anything, he was in attendance with me, or I attended with him. So I would welcome that. The most important reason I went up there was for the boundary modification issues that we were dealing with City of Hayward. There were close to 80 different boundary modification requests in the state of California, and they went through them one by one. So it was really interesting to see the different kinds of disputes, cooperative efforts that were being made across the state of California, what type of issues people are dealing with in trying to address their water rights, things like that. So from that respect, it was very educational in terms of seeing the big picture of what is going on in statewide water. The rest of the session was dealing with Prop 1 grant funding money and the criteria for how they're trying to set up evaluation of these different projects. And this is where I really learned, I think, very firsthand, not only listening to the board, but the DWR staff that was presenting, and then the hallway conversations were just as interesting. And the conclusions that I reached were that DWR really is driven by trying to establish very objective ground rules for evaluating grant Prop 1 funding. They mentioned several times openly that it would be very discouraging if people that were submitting proposals were doing extra lobbying of DWR staff. That just was something that they found a little bit disagreeable. And they really want to stick to the specific criteria that they're trying to establish. During this meeting, they were covering the first of these criteria, which was covering climate change and resiliency to fluctuations in weather patterns. At the next meeting next week, which I'm going to attend as well, it's a two-day session next week, and they're going to cover the secondary ground rules for qualifying Grant 1 funding on project proposals. It was clear to me, I think to Mr. In, that really big projects like Sites Reservoir and Temperance Flat are going to eat up a big chunk of the $2.7 billion that will be made available, perhaps as much as 60-70%. So there are, and were a lot of people in the audience with vested interests in seeing their mid-level and smaller projects come to fruition and obtain funding. We're one of those if it comes to like Los Vaqueros or Lake Del Valle expansion or something. And one of the takeaways I had was that we are in a very, very competitive environment. And people are scrambling right now to find the appropriate engineering consulting firms to assist them and meet the DWR timeline for getting all the proposals in and then doing their evaluations. And there's a shortage of the high quality firms to be able to do this in the state of California. We're in a very competitive environment, and so I think we're going to have to move quickly ASAP to retain a consultant that can help lead our project, really help drive it. Director Whedon and I last Friday were on an Aqua One regional tour, and I'm sorry I did not bring this in tonight, but in our package that we were given was a good example of a multi-agency effort for a Prop 1 application. And I'll bring it in next week or pass it along so that we have it available. It was a good example of what I think we should be doing with East Bay Regional Parks, Santa Clara Valley Water District, and Zone 7. The last point I wanted to make was, and I mentioned this to Mr. Shaver when I came back, I truly was impressed as a citizen and as a taxpayer in California to see my government hard at work. I'm used to working in Silicon Valley in what we call warp speed, you know, where things are really moving fast. But I got the sense with the DWR staff that there's a sense of urgency, that they're trying to get things completed. They're working around the clock. They're setting hard deadlines. And they want the agencies that are involved, interested in Prop 1 money, to have that same sense of urgency if they really want to compete for the dollars. And so I think it was a very valuable one-day trip up there for me to really get that collective impression about what is going on with Prop 1. So I'll just leave it at that for right now, unless Mr. In has something he wants to add.
The only thing I'd like to add is I thought it was interesting, too, that the California Water Commission As far as the basin boundary modification process, their role was only to hear and comment. And they kept repeating that to make sure everybody knew they weren't there to hear an approval process. So that's what they did. They just heard and listened to public comments. And DWR, as part of their schedule, will make some final determinations on Bulletin 118 and compile that by the end of this month. So the process is still moving very quickly.
Director Sethy, if I may, mm-hmm. I have a quick question. I need to apologize because staff didn't get it on the agenda, but you mentioned the Aqua One regional tour.
Yeah.
For the record, I was wondering if that was your report or would you like us to add it to a subsequent meeting? We could do it either way. If you're not prepared to talk about it.
I think we can do it next month because the Director Ween has quite a bit to offer there too. And
okay. In a perfect world, we would have gotten that on the agenda. I apologize for that.
I'll just keep it very brief. It was a very, very good learning experience that day. It's a long trip to go all the way up to Lake Mendocino early in the morning and then come back late in the evening, but we did it.
Okay. Yeah. Request a clarification on the organization. And I was under the impression that the California Water Commission was not part of DWR. They work with DWR, but they're a separate commission. They're not in the structure of DWR.
That's correct.
And therefore, when they talk about lobbying, is it, and the Water Commission would be making the determination on the allocation of the Prop 1 funds, but not only the $2.7 billion for water storage, but also the additional almost $5 billion that are could also apply for some of these projects.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the lobbying of the Water Commission that they were primarily concerned about, not the lobbying of DWR.
No, just the opposite. It was of DWR staff because they are the ones essentially putting together the prioritization on the proposals that they will recommend
to the Water Commission.
Right.
Okay, well, that was, one of the water conferences, I had the opportunity to talk to Jennifer Marr and some representative who was supposed to be the task person on the allocation of those funds and did not realize that she's now concerned about DWR staff.
Oh.
To that end, I still hopefully there's opportunities for us to work with DWR and clarify issues relating to proposals.
Well, the most important thing we can do is to get a firm proposal in working with our potential partners. Okay. It doesn't do any good unless we can get that accomplished first.
Right, and one of the limitations here is public benefit. One of the frustrations of this is that the reoperation of a reservoir under the as passed allowed 100% funding on the part of the of Prop 1 funding, but I understand the California Water Commission has set a maximum of 50% saying that they're going to require matching funds. So the application that was submitted by ACWD in Zone 7 followed those guidelines, but technically that could hopefully be at some point, if there's extra money either from the $2.7 billion or other funds, allow us 100% funding from the Prop 1.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Any other comments for Director Seth?
I would just ask if, I don't know how to formally recommend this, but we have to have somebody that will spearhead this effort on the part of our agency, mm-hmm. and maybe have it come to a periodic review at one of the committees. I would mm-hmm. recommend maybe the Water Resources Committee.
Will do. We're very aware of the schedule requirements for Prop 1 funding. It's a high priority for mm-hmm. staff,
mm-hmm.
and to the extent that staff can focus on that would probably be for the best.
Mm-hmm.
And so, we will provide updates on that process at the Water Resources related committee.
If I may just on that, because I think it's on topic at the moment. The project we're talking about benefits the South Bay Aqueduct contractors who meet on a throughout the year. May I suggest that this be placed on the agenda of that meeting with the opportunity to invite the DWR to the meeting, since it's their property and their assets, to get a status and possibly inform them of what that there is a communal concern and interest in an offer for $7.75 million to address what could be the and resolve the drought problems for the East Bay and South Bay.
I would certainly support that.
Okay. We can explore with our colleagues at Zone 7 and Santa Clara Valley Water District and see where it goes and report to committee.
Okay.
As part of the process.
Thank you. Shall we move on to the next item?
Yeah, on 7.2, Madam President, I already gave a report under director's comments at our June and our July meeting.
Okay.
And so I would just like to put into the record what I said in the minutes. There's not much more to report on here. I believe Director Weed attended a more recent meeting. Did you attend the one last week?
Of the
ACE freight train group that?
Okay, let's stay on topic.
Okay.
This agenda item is specifically for the meeting on June 5th. So yes, we'll put your report back from the last workshop and the last board meeting into the minutes.
Yeah. There are continuing meetings going on. I think you saw there was an article in the newspaper regarding this just recently.
Yeah. The clarification on this is that there was a public meeting on June 5th for the community and was invited. There's a steering group, which I've had the good fortune of sitting in on several of their meetings, that are looking called NEST, Niles for Environmentally Safe Trains, which I will disclose and take appropriate steps but it's a group that's trying to coordinate a response to the issue.
Right.
I have no other director comments.
Thank you. So next one is my item 7.3 is report back from my August 1st meeting with Hayward Mayor Barbara Halliday and city staff. So General Manager Mr. Shaver and I met with Mayor Halliday, the new city manager Ms. McAdoo. So there's that A is pronounced okay, and Alex Amari, who is the head of their public works.
Public Utilities Director.
So originally we scheduled this meeting. The purpose for the meeting is based on my concern that we're having communication issues between ACWD and Hayward. At least from my personal point of view, the feeling is that Hayward staff is not responding to our concerns and our effort to reach out to them and to talk to them to resolve this issue with our northern boundary in Hayward. So as part of this meeting, we have actually agreed to let the administrative process go through to decide on our northern boundary, because the state right now is actually considering this, as Director Sethy has reported back. But I did use the opportunity to reach out to Mayor Halliday, offered to open a new channel communication between the Hayward City Council, the Mayor's Office, and the Board of Directors to ensure that we have good communication going. So in the future, if things like this happen again, we could make sure our staff would talk to each other and that the Director and the Mayor and City Council would talk at our level at a higher objectives and projects. I also highlight the fact that there are projects that are mutually beneficial to the city of Hayward and to ACWD that we could work on. If truly is Hayward's intent to find a lower source of water, there are projects that we could consider as partners that would actually benefit both of us. We did offer clarification. Mayor Halliday and company was under the impression that they are prohibited from pumping water from the two emergency wells they have within City of Hayward. General Manager did a really good job clarifying the fact that there's nothing restricting them from pumping those wells in an emergency. They just have to pay us for the water that we put in that they used. And we also highlighted, compared to San Francisco water, how cheap it is. So hopefully we got our points across. We did have some disagreements, some points of clarification with Mr. Amari. Certain factual disagreements will be very polite in leaving in there, and I believe we made it really clear how ACWD feel about those point of view. But he did make an interesting point. I believe his assertion is that since they were using the groundwater in 1800s, regardless of the fact that they have agreed with us that they were using San Francisco water and they stopped using the groundwater, they still have rights to it. I think that was basically the summary of what he was trying to say, that they pumped the water in 1800s and they could change their mind and pump it again regardless of the fact that we are actually now managing the basin and we're actually recharging the water, and we, ACWD, have been expending significant amount of our customers' money to actually characterize, understand, and manage the ground-based water basin underneath their feet, and that we should, at minimum, be compensated for that. So I think we got those points across, and hopefully we have a new channel of communication. The action item from the meeting is that staff supposed to talk to each other and work on these mutually beneficial projects, but I would encourage general managers to let the board of directors know if you are having communication issues again. We'll be more than glad to pick up the phone or send an email to the council, because now that we have opened a new channel of communication, I, for one, is not shy to take advantage of that just to get things done. Any questions?
I hope we will send them a copy of our centennial publication.
We did. Actually, we did.
We did, and we specifically referred to page 77 of the long book, which illustrates the long and sometimes contentious history between ACWD and, at the time, Eden Township Water and Hayward. And hopefully that information is helpful in Hayward's understanding in terms of ACWD's view that this appears to be history repeating itself. We shall see. So they have copies of the books, and if I may, Hayward is under the impression that ACWD has an interest in controlling development within the city of Hayward. We assured them that that's not the case. The new city manager, Ms. McAdoo, indicated that perhaps an agreement to that effect might be helpful, and essentially said that they would reach out. And I think that wouldn't be a bad idea. In return, our interest is to protect the Niles Cone, and having well permitting authority like we do in Fremont, Newark, and Union City would be especially beneficial to the district. So that could be some form of an agreement that would perhaps benefit both parties and make certain things clear. We'll see how it goes. I've not heard from Hayward since the meeting, so I'll reach out at some point in the future.
Thank you. No more questions from the directors. Then with that, let's move on to closed session. Item 8.1 is pursuant to California Government Code.
We had an item on report comments by board, by members of the board, or is that in the reports? I thought that was a separate.
Actually, let's move on to that. Mm-hmm. It's kind of not specified, but all right. Report from the directors. Director Sethy.
Just one. I have agreed to give a presentation on the history of water in Washington Township, my favorite subject, at the Union City Library on Tuesday, August 30th, at 6:30 to 8 p.m. in the evening. And this is to coincide with the presentation that we have going on over there for the month of August on Director Borgi and his contributions to the district, and the installation of the new APN tank. And so that's it for me.
Director Koller.
No comments.
Director Gunther.
I'm good tonight.
Director Weed.
First, I'll have an opportunity to discuss the trip to Region 1 in more detail, but I was struck by the fact that they are spending almost $9 million per mile to restore a stream in order to allow more fish friendly. And that'll be about 9 miles, about a $100 million project, possibly a little bit less, in lieu of building a large pipe. But as part of that project, they have a parallel stream because they had too much water flowing down the stream. I saw a remarkable parallel, I thought, to our case with Alameda Creek, where if we have too heavy a flow, the fish could not go up the stream. And it struck me that my position on my attitude toward the fish might be dramatically changed if a bypass such as the pipe using the South Bay Aqueduct to deliver water directly to the secret sidewalk, an extension of the South Bay Aqueduct, allowing us to reduce the flows to allow the fish to come in, were part of the project. I could be might be convinced that that was really a good thing to do. In that same line, I would hope that we would consider, as I mentioned earlier, that as part of the California Water Fix, we discussed the concept of the extension of the South Bay Aqueduct through the secret sidewalk right away is a good thing. Beneficiary pays, so our ratepayers would have to pay for it, or property tax, so might have to pay for it, but it would be paid for on the property tax bill. As we expect to pay for the California Water Fix project itself. That'll be part of the litigation with some of the property rights people. But the intent is, I believe, in these California Water Fix, is that will not be charged on our rates, it will be on the property tax bill. That would be a positive thing. In the case of Del Valle, one of the things we can do is get better knowledge and interpretation. So the opportunity to visit the site is something I would encourage us to make invitations both through the South Bay Aqueduct contractors. I was surprised that a director at Santa Clara Valley Water District, who had seemed to show such a great interest, was confused by the presence of the Los Vaqueros Reservoir and the Del Valle Reservoir. And hopefully that's been clarified, and encourage him to at least visit with myself and others if they wish to make the trip, and at least look at the facilities of the East Bay Regional Park District that could be relocated. There is an open space grant, but clearly that grant would not be in a hindrance if we found suitable other space for open space in the area, such as the 5,000 acres recently purchased by Zone 7 adjacent to Del Valle. And finally, I would hope to attend the Water Commission meeting there'd be less than three board members, and that would be, and it was authorized in the agenda earlier this evening. Finally, there is a request by Aqua for recommended legislation. This is an annual occurrence that comes up in September. And we may have missed, for our own internal purposes, the timeline. But a state law that would allow the billing of all utilities on the property tax bill would be a great thing. We have until September 2nd this year to make such a recommendation. It may have to be, if it's determined that it has to be an agenda item, let me encourage us to put it on next year's agenda. But it's certainly something that we can hopefully get some legislation, or get the Aqua to carry the legislation and put something that would be a great statewide benefit. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Reed, and no report from me. So let's now move on to closed session. Item 8.1 is pursuant to California Government Code Section 54956.8, Conference with Real Property Negotiators. The property is the easement and property interest on portions of property owned by Alameda County Water District near the easterly end of Deer Row in Fremont. APN 507-0676-004 and property owned by the City and County of San Francisco adjacent to and to the west of the district property in Fremont. APN 507-0676-005. Agency negotiators are Robert Shaver and Ed Stevenson. Negotiating parties, Rosanna Russell. Under negotiation, price and terms of the payment is 8:25. That's adjourned to the administrative conference room?
Correct.
Administrative conference room. All right, so the time is 9:14. The board has returned from closed session, and the report back is no action taken. With that, I will call the meeting adjourned at 9:14. Want to make it 9:15?